ಗೌರವಾಣಿ ಪ್ರಚಾರಿಣಿ ನಿರ್ವಿಶೇಷ ಶೂನ್ಯವಾದಿ ಪಾಶ್ಚಾತ್ಯ ದೇಶಕಾರಿಣಿ ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಪ್ರಭು ನಿತ್ಯಾನಂದ ಶ್ರೀಮದ್ವೈತ ಗದಾಧರ ಶ್ರೀವಾಸಾದಿ ಗೌರಭಕ್ತವೃಂದ ಹರೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೇ 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 ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೇ ಹರೇ
ಹರೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ
ಹರೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ
ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್ ಆಲ್ ಡಿವೋಟೀಸ್ ಗೀತಾ ಸೆಷನ್ ರೀಡಿಂಗ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತಾ 19th ಶ್ಲೋಕ ಜಗೇನಂ ವೇತ್ತಿ ಹಂತಾರಂ ಯಶ್ಚೈನಂ ಮನ್ಯತೇ ಹತಂ ಭೌತೌ ನ ವಿಜಾನೀತೋ ನಾಯಂ ಹಂತಿ ನ ಹನ್ಯತೇ ಯಏನಂ ವೇತ್ತಿ ಹಂತಾರಂ ಭೌತೌ ನ ವಿಜಾನೀತೋ ನಾಯಂ ಹಂತಿ ನ ಹನ್ಯತೇ soul is so small that it is impossible to kill him by any material weapon, as will be evident from subsequent verses. Nor is the living entity killable because of his spiritual constitution. What is killed or is supposed to be killed is the body only. This, however, does not at all encourage killing of the body. The Vedic injunction is Maa himsyat sarva bhutani. Never commit violence to anyone. Nor does understanding that the living entity is not killed encourage animal slaughter. Killing the body of anyone without authority is abominable and is punishable by the law of the state as well as by the law of the Lord. Arjuna, however, is being engaged in killing for the principle of religion and not whimsically. Hare Krishna.
This shloka spoken by Krishna in the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita authoritatively establishes the eternal nature of the soul. Soul has no death. As in the next shloka also Krishna says, na jayate mriyate va kadachin. The soul has no birth, the soul has no death. And what takes birth is only the body, and what dies is also the body. Whether the death happens through weapons or through some kind of fatal disease or because of natural old age, death is only for the body. And birth, whether the birth takes place in human species or animal species or aquatics or whatever may be the species, the birth is basically birth of the body. This birth and death of a living being are orchestrated by some highly advanced evolved beings. Karmana Daivanitrena. All our karmas, all our activities are observed by many celestial beings. There are 12 kinds of witnesses for all our activities. The sun, the moon, Yavaraj, the super soul, the directions, the day, the night, the presiding deities of days and nights. So there are 12 kinds of witnesses to observe all our activities. The ordinary CC cameras in this world may miss capturing some shots, probably. Or their range is only limited, probably. But the Lord's CC cameras are installed right within the hearts of all living beings. They will never miss recording anything. And memory is never free. Nowadays, people are very conscious while they are driving. They are even conscious of touching mobile while driving because cameras are there. They click photos. That day, at that moment, on that road, when you are driving, you are checking mobile. So, they are not even touching mobile while driving. In some countries, it's like that. I don't know about this country, but in some countries, things are very strict. If we are so conscious of the cameras installed everywhere by human beings, how much conscious we need to be when we understand that there are cameras everywhere, super souls, eyes are everywhere. The Upanishad also says, and many Vedic literatures say, the Lord has eyes everywhere, ears everywhere. Although you may speak something negative about somebody, gossiping about someone, that someone may not know it, but Krishna knows it. Super soul knows it. Although we are speaking ill about someone, or planning something harmful to someone, that person may not know, but Krishna knows. He's super soul. And sometimes we may do so many good things, people don't acknowledge us. People don't appreciate us. They don't even recognize us. You may feel a little disappointed. How many of you had the experience of being disappointed or not being recognized for the good work we have done? This world. Many. But rest assured, Krishna notices our good work and He rewards us. Human beings may not be able to reward or even recognize, but the divine eyes will never fail in recognizing and rewarding as per what we deserve. However, the mistakes are also recorded like that only. So, in the context of this current shloka, birth and death exist for the
body and not the soul. And birth of the soul in a particular species is in accordance with the activities that the living being has done in the past life. Karmana Daivanyatrena. All the activities that we have done are witnessed by some higher authorities, and some decision is made, okay, this person deserves to enter this species in the next life. And that entrance into another species or another material body is birth. And once the tenure in that body is completed, once the predestined tenure in that body is finished, then there is death. So the soul is passing through this cycle of birth and death through various material bodies. But ultimately, the soul is divine. Just like you have a golden ring that may fall in sewage as you are doing Vrindavan Parikrama. And some pigs are there. They are little scared to move, scared to go close because the pig may do something else, some other pastimes. But still, you can't leave it and then move ahead. It's 50,000 rupees or 1 lakh rupees diamond golden ring, diamond studded golden ring. You can't just leave it like that. Somehow you manage to pick it up. Take a stick or something to do. Pick it up. Use your hand also. You pick it up. How can you lose it? You can wash it and then reuse it. Because you know, this golden ring doesn't lose its value despite falling in gutter. If it is face mask, or handkerchief, or some paper, printout, then you may not pick it up. But if it is golden ring, then you will pick it up, because it doesn't lose its value. Similarly, although the soul falls into this material existence and passes through this material species and spends for long years, spends time in this material world undergoing so many miseries, still the soul doesn't lose its innate, intrinsic, eternal characteristic as Sat Chit Ananda. Sat, the soul is eternal. The eternal nature of the soul is never lost. Soul is eternal. Eternally eternal. Chit, soul is knowledgeable. Ananda, soul is blissful. But the Chit and Ananda aspects of the soul can be covered. They are not lost, they are covered. Just like that golden ring fell into the gutter. Its brilliance is not seen. The diamond ring, when you are wearing it, it shines nicely. Right? But when it falls into gutter, it is buried in the sewage, then its shine is covered. It's not visible. Similarly, when the soul falls into this material world, then the knowledge is covered, ananda, bliss is covered. So, similarly, the soul also, the soul whose knowledge is covered by ignorance, whose bliss is covered by material pursuits, can be reinstated in its original glory, mahim visvem hiyate, by the path of bhakti. So Prabhupada writes in the purport that this understanding that the soul doesn't die, only the body dies, and even if you don't kill, body will anyways die, that doesn't encourage animal slaughter. That doesn't encourage unnecessary killing of the bodies of living entities. You are not killing the person, you are only killing the body. But the body should not be killed unnecessarily. So that's the message that Prabhupada writes here. Na himsyat sarva bhutani. Never commit violence against anyone. So Prabhupada quotes some Vedic phrase. So we should not be violent towards the bodies, that is understood. However, this word violence that is committed to another living being is not just physical violence. The word violence has a broader perspective. If we speak harsh words to discourage others, to disappoint others, to disrespect or demean others, belittle others, that is violence committed gains their mind. If you steal someone else's ideas, or if you don't acknowledge someone's intelligent nature or thoughts, there's violence committed against intelligence. And if you dishonor somebody, disrespect someone, speak some foul words or insulting words, that their ego gets hurt, that is violence committed. And if you don't value their position, then committing violence against ego. Ego is not a negative word as such. Ego is a sense of identity. If you don't acknowledge their identity, insult them, then it's violence. So violence is not committed only on the gross bodily platform. Violence is committed against the subtle body of the living entity also. Subtle violence. So let us not commit any violence. Just because mind is material, intelligence is material, eyes are material, legs are material, hands are material, body is material, that does not mean the body has to be subjected to violence. One will definitely incur sinful reactions for committing violence against the bodies of other people. Our understanding of the eternal nature of the soul should not induce us to become indifferent to the body. Similarly, we cannot commit violence against our own body also. If we are misusing our body, or overusing our body, overstretching our body, not in exercise, overstretching does not mean we are doing some stretching exercises, but for unnecessary material pleasures, people use their bodies in unmentionable ways. That's basically torturing the body. To extract more and more pleasure from one's own body or from others' bodies, they commit violence. They kind of reduce one's lifespan. Their vital energy is diminished because of committing violence against one's own body. One may think it is pleasure, but it is violence. Anything that is overly used or inappropriately used is violence. So violence has a very broad perspective. So these are a few thoughts on this shloka as I read the purport.
Yaenam vetti hantaram yaschenam manyate hatam ubhautau na vijaniyito nayam hanti nahanyate.
So soul can never be killed. Soul cannot kill others. So that is very clear. And Krishna also writes, speaks in the next few shlokas that your wind weapon cannot wither the soul, your water weapon cannot moisten the soul. So he speaks all those characteristics of the soul. But the purpose of human life is in realizing our spiritual nature as spirit souls and trying to come out of this material entanglement. Most people don't even realize that they are souls. Most people consciously or unconsciously identify themselves with their material bodies or material minds or material egos or designations. They over-identify with their thoughts and intellectual patterns and egoistic positions, and they ignore their own spiritual identities. That creates a great problem. And that induces the soul to take one more birth after birth. How do we stop this? We practice bhakti yoga and sincerely take shelter of the Lord. Then this can be stopped.
Samsaram bhasi sambhrutam bhrama bhare gambhirata patraya graheena vigrihita mugragatina kroshantam antarbhayat Deeptrena adya sudarshanena vibhudha klantichhita karina chinta santati ruddha buddhara hare machitta dantishwaram. Samsaram bhasi sambhrutam brahma bhare.
We are caught up in this samsara. Samsara means the cycle of birth and death. Samsara ambhasi. Ambhasi means this great ocean. This material existence और संसारा इज लाइक एन ओशन. Samsarambhasi sambhurta brahma bhare. Brahma bhare means this material ocean is filled with so many illusions and bewilderments and distractions and allurements. Brahma bhare. Not just that, not just temptations and illusions. Gambhirata apatraya. Very grave, very intense apatraya. The threefold material miseries. We are caught up in this samsara. Samsarambhasi sambhruta brahma bhare gambhirata patraya grahenabhigrihita mugragatina krushantam antarbhayat. Very scary shloka. Already are caught up in this material ocean. The waves are tossing us. But there is a crocodile that comes and catches our leg. Rajendra also thought, this crocodile may leave me after 5 minutes or 10 minutes or 20 minutes or maybe one day. But for 1,000 years, the crocodile was catching Gajendra's feet. Similarly, for thousands of lifetimes, as we are drowning in this or being tossed in this material ocean, crocodile, the Maya crocodile may catch us. Grahena abhigrihita ugra gatina. Ugra gatimanna means very intensely. Graha means crocodile. Grahenabhi abhigrihita. So graha, this crocodile, has caught the leg of this conditioned soul. Ugragatina, very intensely. Then what is the conditioned soul doing? Akroshantam antarbhayat. Internally he is experiencing so much fear and he is doing akrosha. Akrosha means? Akrosha means, anyone knows? Crying, lamenting, screaming, yelling at the top of his voice. Akrosha. Akrosham antar bhayat. He is fearful. Oh, what will happen? This crocodile will swallow me. Already is in the ocean. That itself is a very piteous situation. On top of it, in the ocean, he is caught by a crocodile. Whether we realize it or not, whether we realize it today or tomorrow or after 10 years or after 10,000 lifetimes, this is our condition in this material world. Grahena vigrihita mugra gatina kroshantam antar bhayat. Deeptrenadhya sudarshanena vibhudha klantichida karina. In such a situation, we need to offer prayer to the Lord. O Lord, deeptrenadhya sudarshanena vibhudha. Today, you please release your sudarshana chakra. And what is the glory of the sudarshana chakra? Deeptrenadhya sudarshanena vibhudha klantichida karina. Vibhudha means devatas. The Sudarshan Chakra has the track record of protecting even great devadas also from their calamities. I am just a human being, rotting in this material existence. You can easily protect me. Release your Sudarshan Chakra. Chinta santati ruddha muddhara hare machitta dantishwaram. Chinta santati. I am totally caught up in this chinta, so many anxieties. Uddhara hare, oh hari, uddhara karo. Please, please protect me. Please uplift me. Please deliver me. My chitta dantishwaram, my chitta, my mind is like the dantishwara. Danti means one who has big tusks, that is elephant. Dantishwara means the king of all elephants, Gajendra. So this devotee who is offering this prayer is saying that my chitta, my mind is like that Gajendra who is caught up in this ocean of material existence, caught by this crocodile. Oh Lord, just like you protected Gajendra by releasing your Sudarshan Chakra, you please protect me also. This is how we should pray to the Lord. Then we will come out of this cycle of birth and death. And whenever a devotee sincerely prays, the Lord appears. Bhakta paya bhujanga garudamani trailokya rakshamani gopi lochana chataka budamani saundarya mudravani yah kantamani rukmini Ghanakucha dvandvaika bhoshamani Shreyo deva shikha vadir dishatuno Gopala chodamani Bhakta paya bhujanga garudamani. Whenever a devotee is in trouble and whenever the devotee who is in trouble is offering sincere, heartfelt, desperate, anxious prayers for the Lord's protection, the Lord comes. Bhujanga garudamani. He appears like a blue, shining gem on the top of this great mountain like Garuda. Bhakta paya bhujanga garudamani trailokya rakshamani And he does rakshan, he gives protection to all his devotees who are rotting in this material existence, who are drowning in this samsara, ambhasi, sambhrita, brahma, bhare, gambhira, tapatraya. So many tapatrayas. First we need to realize that I am in a situation which is really, really sensitive, very fragile. Most people don't even realize that they are in the jaws of crocodile, drowning in this material ocean. Most people don't even realize. They don't even realize what will, how will the Lord will not come and protect. Narada Muni had a wonderful conversation with Yudhishthira Maharaj one day. That's recorded in the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, 13th chapter. You can go and see. He says, you know the context? Yudhishthira Maharaj was feeling that my uncle Dhritarashtra, another uncle Vidura, aunt Gandhari, these three people left me. Without even informing me, they left my palace. Maybe they are offended by my offenses. Maybe they have taken my offense of killing their 100 sons very seriously and they have abandoned me. They are very old. I am supposed to be serving them and protecting them. But they left me because they may be upset because of my offenses. He was lamenting. And Narada Muni came and said, my dear sir, Yudhishthira Maharaj, O great emperor, do you really think that you are the protector of these three people? Or you are the protector of their citizens? Do you really think you are the protector of anybody in this planet? No. Sometimes we take great pleasure when others are dependent on us, when others are taking guidance from us, when others are asking us suggestions, Prabhu, what am I supposed to do? Can you please tell me, please tell me? Some ego is boosted within me. You see, it happens sometimes. And sometimes when others are not taking guidance from us, we feel little lonely. I am so experienced, I am so talented, I am so wise. Nobody is taking my suggestions. They are ignoring me. They are insulting me. Apman hai. Sometimes people feel little lonely or left out when others don't take their guidance. Probably it is our need to guide them rather than their need to take guidance from us. It is our need to be dependable than their need to depend on us. So we take pleasure or we depend on others' dependence on us. That's a problem. Whether we realize it or not. Everybody is dependent on Krishna. If we think can depend on somebody else, that's an illusion. And if we think others should depend on me, that's a bigger illusion. We can depend on Krishna only, and we can depend on a representative of Krishna, who is empowered by Krishna, who gives you shelter or who gives you guidance on behalf of Krishna and transmits the teachings of Krishna nicely. That is Guru and other Vaishnavas. That kind of dependence is bona fide, where Krishna is in the center. Keeping Krishna outside the picture, whatever dependence that one living entity has on other living entity is only an illusion. Kala karma guna dhino deho yam pancha bhautikaham katham anyastu gopayet sarpa grastho yathaparam. Narada Muni says this to Yudhishthira Maharaj. I wanted to quote this in this context. Kala karma guna adhino. We are all under the adhina, under the control of, under the subjugation of kala, time. Karma, our own fruitive baggage. Guna, the three material modes, sattva, rajas, tamo gunas. Adhina, we are under their control. Kala, karma, guna, adhino, dehoyam, we are under the control of this own body. We are entrapped in this body. A human body cannot fly like a crow in the sky. A crow cannot speak like a human being. Every body has its limitations and the soul who is inside the body is limited by the nature of the body, right? Dehoyam. Pancha bhautikaha. And there are five pancha mahabhutas, earth, water, fire, and ether. And they are also controlling us in so many ways. You want to go out, it's raining. Water is troubling you. or other elements keep troubling you. Wind is troubling us sometimes. When I was in Wellington, wind was troubling. When I was in Perth, water was troubling. It was raining heavily, quite heavily. So elements will trouble us. Kala karma guna dhino dehoyam pancha bhautikah katham anyastu gopaya sarpakrasto yathaparam. If you yourself are troubled by these five things, kala karma guna deha pancha bhautikah, how can you protect someone else? Katham anyastu gopaya? Where is your ability to protect anyone else? Where is the possibility of offering any support to anybody else? It's like sarpakrasto yathaparam. A sarpa, a great python, is swallowing you, right? You're entering into the body of the python. Already the python has caught your leg, swallowed your leg, and little portion of your waist also. At that moment you found somebody in some trouble. Come, I'll help you. You extend a helping hand. What will happen? Both of you will go into python's mouth. Right? I'm not saying this, Narada is saying this. Sarpo kala karma guna dhino dehoyam pancha bhautikah katham anyastu gopayat. How can you protect someone else? Sarpagrastho yathaparam. You are a sarpagrastha yathaparam. You are trying to protect someone else. That is not protection, that is destruction. So let us never consider ourselves protector of someone. Ego. Maya is so powerful that it can induce egoistic feelings in someone who is practicing bhakti and reading Bhagavad Gita also. You are reading Bhagavad Gita. You understand. So many things you keep reading and you keep telling other people. At one point you may think, I am such a great scholar of Bhagavad Gita. I am enlightening these people in the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita. They are learning from me. I am such a great philosopher or teacher or scholar. I am a deliverer. I am this, I am that. That is Maya. While reading Bhagavad Gita also, Mama Maya Duratyaya. That's not a normal statement. We have to take shelter of Krishna. To that degree we take shelter of Jagannathji, to that degree we can bring people closer to Jagannathji. To that degree we take shelter of our own ego. Those who are coming closer to us, they only boost our ego. Their surrender, their submissiveness, their respect that they give you, that will only become a boost for our own false ego. We will fall in the deeper trap of Maya. We need to be conscious. Take shelter of Krishna sincerely. Pride, ego, superiority complex, a sense of being a protector of others. Narada Muni told Yudhishthira Maharaj, you are not protecting anybody. Please understand Krishna is the protector. He has made a system. Ahastani sahastanam apadani chatushpadam falguni tatra mahatam jivo jivasya jivanam. Ahastani sahastanam. Those who do not have hands are natural food for those who have hands. Apadani chatushpadam. Those who do not have legs, those living beings are natural food for those who have legs. Falguni tatra mahatam. Greater living entities consume smaller living entities, and so that's how they sustain. Jivo jivasya jivanam. In this way, the Lord has designed this world in which one jiva is dependent naturally on another jiva. We eat plants, we eat fruits, we eat vegetables, we survive. So that is natural cycle. If we think I am protecting somebody else, then that's an illusion. Even if you are feeding somebody, you are feeding the vegetables that the Lord has given us. Right? They are just processing the vegetables in a certain way. So we should never take credit for whatever we are doing. Anyways, so the main point is that the soul, the living being, especially human being, must realize that I am supposed to be rendering spiritual activities, performing spiritual activities in the service of the Lord, but somehow I am tricked and trapped in this material world to do so many materialistic activities. So let me realize my fallen condition and take shelter of Krishna, and Krishna will protect. Krishna rakshatu no jagatraya guru krishnam namadvam sadam krishne nakhila shatrabo vinihata krishnaya tasmai namah krishna deva sabuddhitam jagatidam krishnasya dasosmyaham krishne tishthati vishvaveda dakhilam he krishna rakshasvam Krishna Rakshatu no, Jagattaraya Guru. Krishna is the real teacher of the entire universe and only Krishna can protect us. Krishnam namadham sadha. Let us offer obeisances to Lord Krishna only. Krishna akila shatravo vidihataha. It is only Krishna who can destroy all our shatrus. Krishna yatasmai namah. Offer obeisances to Krishna only. Krishna deva samutthitam jagatitam. It is from Krishna that this entire jagat has manifested. Krishna is the source of this universe. Krishnasya dasosmyaham. Let us consider ourselves as servants of Krishna. Krishna tishthati vishvameta dakhinam. Hey Krishna rakshasvamam. This entire universe goes back into Krishna's body after its annihilation. He is the shelter of this universe. He is the shelter of all living beings in the universe. Therefore, let us take shelter of Krishna. And how to take shelter of Krishna? By chanting the holy names of Krishna. Again, one more example, shloka, where the material world is compared with an ocean. Kulashekhar Alvar says this shloka in the Mukunda Mala Stotra. He martya paramam hitam shrutavo vakshyami sankshepata. Samsararnava mapa durmi bahulam samyak pravishya sthita nana jnanam apasya chetasina bodharayana yetyavum mantram sapranavam pranava sahitam pravarta yidham muhum. O Martya, O human being, please realize your condition in this material world. Paramam hitam shrutavo. I am going to give you a very, very effective advice to come out of this situation. First, realize your situation. What is the situation? Samsararnava mapa durmi bahulam samyak pravishya sthitaha. You have entered deep into this material ocean that is filled with waves of hundreds and thousands of difficulties. Realize that. Even Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, janma mrityu jara vyadhi dukkha doshanu darshanam. Only when you understand and realize that birth, death, old age and disease are causes of misery, you have understood your condition in this material world. But most people don't even realize that birth, death, old age, disease are actual miseries. Although they are undergoing miseries, they think, I will recover after some time. I have seen hundreds of deaths, but still they will think they may not die. Or they work as if they are going to live here forever, even in the fag end of their lives. Even if they are very, very old, still a lot of hopes in this world, a lot of desires to fulfill in this world. So much. But the fact of life is, this body is temporary, the soul is permanent, and the soul attains the supreme bliss not in bodily enjoyment but only in service to Krishna. So how do we be reinstated? How are we reinstated in that original position? Kulshekarwar continues in this shloka. Samsararnava mapa durmi bahulam samyakta vishya sthita nana jnanama pasya chetasina bonarayana yetyavum. Give up all your concocted plans to come out of this material ocean. Just take my advice. Nothing else. What is that? Chant the names of Lord Narayana. Simple. Chant the holy names of Narayana, then you will come out of this network of material existence. Narayana yetyavum mantram sapranavam pranama sahitam pravartha yadham muhu. Chant this mantra along with pranava omkara, then it becomes om namo narayanaya. Mantram sa pranavam pranama sahitam pravarta yadham. And do this practice, chant the holy names of Krishna always, constant, regular. Then you can come out of this material ocean. Even Satyavratamani, in his Damodara Ashtakam, he says, Namo deva damodara ananta vishnu prasida prabho dukha jalabdhi magnam kripa drishti vrishtyati dinam batano grihanesha mamagnam edhyakshidrishi. Namo deva दामोदर अनंत विष्णु प्रसीद प्रभो स्टैंडिंग सो मेनी होली नेम्स ऑफ द लॉर्ड कृपा दृष्टि वृष्टि प्लीज शावर सम लविंग ग्लांसेस अपॉन अस अपॉन मी भाई व्हाट्स योर क्वालिफिकेशन टू गेट माय कृपा दृष्टि देन ही यूजेस क्वालिफिकेशन ग्रेट क्वालिफिकेशन व्हाट इज दैट आई एम इमर्स्ड इन एन ओशन ऑफ नेटवर्क ऑफ मिजरीज दैट्स माय क्वालिफिकेशन नमो देव दामोदर अनंत विष्णु प्रसीद प्रभो दुख जालाभिमग्नम दुख मीन्स डिस्ट्रेस Jala means network, Abdhi means ocean, Magna means I am immersed in an ocean of network of miseries. Please protect me. I am Atidino, second qualification. I am Atidino, very, very fallen. Okay, find some way to come out. Then he said, Agnam, I am ignorant of coming out of this material existence. Only you have to protect me. I am ignorant of my own means of deliverance. In this way, when we offer prayer to the Lord, heartfelt prayer to the Lord, and sincerely beg for the Lord's support and protection, and that is the way out of this material existence. Unless we sincerely, seriously, and exclusively take shelter of the Lord, realizing our fallen conditions, there is no possibility of coming out of this material world. It's not a random event. It's a consciously chosen path to serve the Lord, to love the Lord, to take shelter of the Lord. Devi hesha gunavayi mama maya duratyaya mame vaye prapadyante mayam etam taratikiti. This maya, our material energy that consists of three material modes of rajas tamo gunas, is very difficult to surpass. Only by taking shelter of the Lord, we will be able to cross over this material existence and attain the lotus feet of the Lord. And it is not very expensive to serve the Lord. The Lord is not expecting any expensive gifts from us. The Lord expects sincere intent from us, sincere devotion from us. No expensive gifts are expected. If you want, you can give. Definitely, Lord can take it. But the Lord values the sincerity of feeling more than the magnitude of offering. Hanumanji was getting big boulders for the construction of this bridge across the Lanka ocean. But a little squirrel is only pushing some sand particles, little bubbles, just to fill in the gaps between the big boulders. That's also required, right? The Lord is impressed with both of them. Hanumanji is pleasing the Lord. Squirrel is also pleasing the Lord. Lord Ramachandra is equally impressed with both of them. So the Lord is impressed with the attitude behind our service more than the magnitude of our service. He is impressed with the sincerity of our feeling more than the greatness of our offering. So let us focus on that quality of feeling and then connect with the Lord. Then the Lord will definitely take us into His loving company. Even if you happen to be so poverty stricken that you cannot offer patram, pushpam, phalam, toyam also. Still, if you have sincere desire, you close your eyes and offer patram, pushpam, phalam, toyam within your mind. The Lord will help us. There is a beautiful shloka. Again, from the Mukunda Malastha. Nathenah purushottametri jagataham ekadhipe chetasam सेव्ये स्वस्य पदस्य दातरि परे नारायणे तिष्ठति यं कञ्चित् पुरुषाधमं कतिपया ग्रामेशमल्पार्थदम् सेवायै मृगया महेन रमहो मूढावराकावयम् नाथेन पुरुषोत्तमे त्रिजगतां ओ नाथ यर पुरुषोत्तम यर द बेस्ट ऑफ ऑल living entities. Tri Jagatam Natha. You are the master of all the three worlds. Nathenaha Purushottame Tri Jagatam Ekadhipe. Ekadhipe, one and only master of these three worlds. And in fact, all the universes. See, Chetasa Sevye, even if someone renders service to you within your mind, within their minds, mental service, the Lord will offer His own abode to you. Sevye Svasya Padasya Data Ripare Narayani Tishthati. Even if someone happens to render service to Lord Vishnu, Lord Krishna, within one's mind, because of lack of proper means to serve, the Lord is impressed with such a service and the Lord will give His own abode to such a devotee. You want an example? There is a devotee in Pratishthanpur. Prabhu Goswami writes about this devotee in Bhaktirasamrita Sindhu. Bhaktirasamrita Sindhu is not a storybook. It is pure philosophy, explanation of science of bhakti. But still, no story is mentioned there. This Pratishthanpur Brahmana wanted to serve the Lord, wanted to make very magnificent offerings to the Lord, but still he did not have the means. He is very poor Brahmana. Understand, poor Brahmana is poor Brahmana. One day he went for a satsang program, and in the satsang program the speaker is saying that if you don't have proper means to serve the Lord, you can offer many valuable things to the Lord within your mind, in your imagination. Then this Brahmana came and started worshipping the Lord within his mind. He took his bath, he sat down and he closed his eyes. He installed a deity of Lord Narayana there. And he went to river Godavari and took a golden pot and brought Godavari water in that golden pot. Then he went to Kaveri River, got a golden pot of water from Kaveri. Then Yamuna, Ganga, he went to all holy rivers. Physically, he went within his imagination and brought all these waters. And he started bathing the Lord's deity form with that water from all holy rivers. Then again, in his imagination, he brought liters and liters of milk and yogurt and honey and sugar water and Panchagavya water. And with this Panchamrit, he did Abhishek of the Lord, honey, within his imagination. Then he also offered expensive ornaments to the Lord, expensive clothes to the Lord, nicely prepared garlands to the Lord, all within his imagination. And he also offered wonderful, amazing bhoga to the Lord within his imagination. Close your eyes and start meditating on this. Not when you have the means to offer them physically, but only when you don't have the means to offer them physically, you can take to this imagination as Pratishthanpur Brahmana. So he was offering many things. One day, this was continuing for a long, long time. One day within his imagination, he wanted to offer sweet rice to the Lord. Every day he changes items also. No monotony. No expense, right? So he wanted to offer sweet rice. He got milk, quality milk. That is taken from a cow. He took some rice, he took sugar, he took whatever, ghee, and many things. And he prepared sweet rice nicely. So he wanted to offer it after it cools down little. So he wanted to check the temperature of the sweet rice. He kept his finger in the sweet rice to check whether it is sufficiently cool or not so that it can be offered to the Lord. But as soon as he put his finger in the sweet rice, the finger got burnt. Not in imagination, really. He made sweet rice in imagination. He burnt his hand really. There is no fire there physically, but he burnt his hand in reality. Then he was surprised. His meditation broke. He opened his eyes and he started doing like this. And seeing this whole incident, Lord Narayana in Vaikuntha started laughing. He was laughing so much. And Lakshmidevi was bewildered. What happened? Did he crack some joke or what? Did he do some comedy or what? Why are you laughing, my dear Lord, suddenly out of the blue? Then Lord Narayana said, I will not tell you. I will show you. Wait for a minute. He called Come Vishnu Dutas, come here, come here. Take Vaikuntha airplane, it's boarded there. Take Vaikuntha airplane, go to Pratishthanpur. There's a Brahmana who is worshipping me. You will not find a deity, but he's worshipping me. Understand that. You will not find a deity, you will not find any deity paraphernalia there. You will not find any worship paraphernalia or any garlands or ornaments or dresses or necklaces. You will not find anything, but he's worshipping. He's sitting there alone. Go and get him here. And all this is happening not in imagination, it's reality. So why couldn't airplane descended? And Pratishthanpur Brahmana is doing like this. My hand got burnt. Then Vaikuntha airplane came down and Vaikuntha attendants, Vishnu Parshadas, Vishnu Dutas, invited Pratishthanpur Brahmana, please board the airplane. He was bewildered. Who are you? What is this invitation? We are Narayana Dutas, Vishnu Dutas, who came to take you to Vaikuntha. Lord Vishnu had sent this airplane. And you are not imagining. It's reality. Come. Come, we are going to take you to Vaikuntha. Really? Yeah, please come. So he just boarded the airplane. Within no time, he's in Vaikuntha. And Lord Vishnu showed that devotee, Brahmana, to Lakshmi Devi and said, see, he is daily worshipping me without any paraphernalia. Very inexpensive. No investment at all. He was closing his eyes and he's daily worshipping me. And he's worshipping me with such sincerity. He is so attentive to all the details of my worship within his imagination that I'm so impressed with him and I brought him here. That's why I was laughing. He was burnt his hand while making a sweet rice within his imagination. Then he told the Brahmana, you stay here only. You don't have to go to Pratishthanpur again. You stay here and physically serve me. No more imagination. Right? We are in Vaikuntha now. And the Brahmana became overwhelmed. So, the shloka that we were discussing is Sevye Svasya Padasya Data Ripare Narayani Tishkati. Even if a devotee renders service to the Lord in imagination, still the Lord is pleased enough to offer him his own abode, to offer the devotee his own spiritual abode and invite him into his loving association. The Lord is Purushottama. But our misfortune is that we give up that Purushottama and start serving Purushadhamas. Yam kanchit Purushadhamam katipaya gramesha malpathadam. Giving up that Purushottama, the Supreme Lord, we render service to Purushadhamas, means the lowest of mankind. Gramesham, they may be lots of landlords of small villages. Alpartadam, for meager amount of salary, we start serving them. And they will give some salary at the end of the month. Sometimes they will skip that also. Sometimes they reduce it also. They will cut also. Yam kanchit purushadhamam katipaya grahamesham alpartadam. For alpartadam, for meager amount of happiness, we are serving so many purushadhamas. Sevayai mrugaya mahena ramaho mudha varaka vayam. I'm serving them. Mudha. I'm such a fallen, foolish person. Varaka vayam, very fallen person. Oh Lord, please give me inspiration to serve you. Not that you should not do jobs, not that you should not get salaries. Whatever you need to do to maintain the body in this world, do the needful. But the point is, don't ignore the worship of Purushottama while serving normal people in this world. That will reinstate us in our original glory as soul, as spirit souls, as against people who are entrapped in the material body conditions. Just as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Namna Makari Mudhani Dharma Shakti Tatrarpita Niyamita Smarani Nakalaha. Although the Lord has invested all his potencies in his holy names, still, although the holy names are very merciful, although there are not many rules and regulations to chant the holy names, but the holy names can be chanted at any time, at any place, by anyone, still, Durdaiva Vitrishamiha Jani Na Anuragaha. Our Durdaivam, our misfortune is that we have no anuraga, we have no attraction towards chanting the holy names of the Lord. Although the Lord gives his own abode to someone who renders service to him in imagination, still we have no taste to serve him, but we are serving materialistic people. The similar lines, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also says, although the holy name is so merciful, so accessible, Namavatar, but still we don't have sufficient taste for the holy names. So we need to beg for the taste to chant the holy names of the Lord. We need to invest our quality, time, and love and affection and feelings and emotions in the process of chanting the holy names of the Lord as much as we can. And we need to keep on increasing that practice to eventually come to a stage where we chant in ecstasy. We chant with emotions. We chant with tears rolling down our ears. Then we are in our original glorious spirit source. Till then, we are rotting in the material existence. The soul is reinstated in its original glory only by the process of bhakti yoga. That's why when Parikshit Maharaj asked Sukadeva Goswami, "Oh Lord, my dear spiritual master, can you please tell me what a person is supposed to do throughout one's life and what a person is supposed to do especially at the time of death?" Sukadeva Goswami gave a profound answer. All you need to do throughout your life and at the end of one's life is chanting the glories of the Lord, hearing the names of the Lord, and remembering the Lord. That's all. That's all you need to do. Yannama Shruti Matrena Puman Bhavati Nirmalaha. Just by hearing the holy name of the Lord, Bhavati Nirmalaha, our heart will become Nirmala, devoid of any contamination. All contamination in the heart is completely eradicated by chanting the holy names of the Lord. Then Nama Suti Matrena, what to speak of chanting the names of the Lord? What to speak of making others chant the holy names of the Lord? That's not an easy task. But one who happens to do that acquires profuse blessings of the Lord and attains the lotus feet of the Lord. Sukadeva Goswami says, Tasmad Bharata Sarvatma Bhagavanishvaro Hari Shrotavyaha Kirtitavyascha Dheyaha Poojascha Nityadha. Tasmad Bharata Sarvatma, O descendant of Bharata dynasty, my dear Parikshit Maharaj, Sarvatma Bhagavan Ishvaro Hari. The Lord is described in four words here. Sarvatma is the super soul of everyone. Bhagavan is the possessor of all appearances. Ishvara is the supreme controller. Hari, he steals all miseries of his devotees. Tasmat Bharata Sarvatma Bhagavan Ishvaro Harihi Shrotavya Kirtitavyascha. Shrotavya, hear about him. Kirtitavyascha, chant his holy names. Smartavyascha, remember him. Dheyascha Poojascha Nityada, you remember him, you worship him Nityada, regularly do this activity, then you will be reinstated in your original constitutional position as a servant of the Lord. Out of this material existence, rotting in this material existence. Let's conclude by remembering one more shloka. Somehow I'm remembering multiple Mukulmala shloka shlokas. How potent is the holy name of Krishna? Shatru Chedaika Mantram Sakalam Upanishadvakya Sampoojya Mantram Samsarochheda Mantram Samuchita Tamasaha Sanghaniryana Mantram Sarvaishvaryaika Mantram Vyasana Bhujaga Sandashta Santrana Mantram Jihve Sri Krishna Mantram Japa Japa Satatam Janmasabhalya Mantram Shatruchhedaika Mantram. Chanting Krishna Mantra can destroy all our Shatrus. Who are our Shatrus? Not other living beings. He is my enemy, she is my enemy. That's not Shatru. Real Shatru is inside. The lust, the envy, the pride, the greed, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madhavasya, the six anarthas are our real Shatrus. By chanting the holy names of the Lord, the Shatrus are destroyed. Shatru Chedaika Mantram Sakalam Upanishadvakya Sampoojya Mantram. All the Upanishads are being puja of this mantra, Krishna mantra. Basically, they are recommending this mantra repeatedly. Samsaro Cheda Mantram. Our tenure in this material existence is terminated by chanting Krishna mantra. You have to terminate or you have to continue? If continuation is our aim, don't chant Krishna's mantra. Termination is our aim, chant. Samsarochheda mantram samuchita tamasaha sanghanirayana mantram samuchita tamasaha sanghanirayana mantram. Our association with this dark material existence will be eradicated, will be vanquished, will be disconnected when you chant Krishna mantra. If you are interested in this samsara, don't chant Krishna mantra. Very dangerous. But if you have no interest in samsara, then chant Krishna mantra. Samsaro cheda mantram samuchita tamasaha sanghanirayana mantram sarvaishwaryaika mantram. This mantra, Krishna mantra, can give you all aishwaryas. It's all opulences. What are the opulences that a devotee can aspire for? He says he has to be detached from the material world. Again, he desires opulence and he will get that opulence from Krishna mantra. The real opulence of a living being is not gold or silver or diamonds or palaces. The real opulence of a soul is love for Krishna. Krishna prema. Krishna naam can give us Krishna prema. Samsarochheda mantram samuchita tamasaha sanghanirayana mantram sarvaishwaryaika mantram vyasana bhujaga sandashta santrana mantram. Vyasana bhujaga, all our bad habits and allurements and temptations in this world are like bhujaga, they are like snakes. Just like say snake charmer comes and then plays his special musical instrument and chants some mantras to subdue snakes. Similarly, this Krishna mantra, musical singing or melodious chanting of Krishna mantra acts like a snake charmer that can subdue snakes. Who are the snakes? The materialistic habits, the temptations that we have, the attachments that we have. Vyasana bhujaga sandashta santrana mantram jihve sri Krishna mantram japa japa satatam janma sabhalya mantram. Chant constantly. Japa japa satatam. Constantly chant the names of Krishna. Janma sabhalya mantram. Your life will become successful, fruitful, meaningful, useful. Otherwise, life becomes useless. Therefore, let us take shelter of the holy names of Krishna. Take shelter of the process of Bhakti Yoga and acknowledge Lord Krishna's efforts to reclaim us. He descends in multiple forms, Sambhavami Yuga Yuga, only to reclaim us. He appeared just 5 centuries back in the form of Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to teach us the holy names of Krishna, to teach us the process of Harinam Sankirtan, and thus reclaim all of us. Discuss many more things, but I think I'll stop here. Any questions or comments?